James Heinz Jr. and Robert Moore are co-founders of Marquette Partners, a liquidity provider specializing in exchange-traded derivatives, and one of the first firms to see the potential in electronic markets for futures and options. Heinz's journey began in 1978 when he became one of the original Treasury bond permit holders at the Chicago Board of Trade. By 1981, he had become a full CBOT member. He also showed an early affinity for technology, experimenting in the mid-1980s with an Apple computer for data analysis. Moore's journey in the futures market followed a similar path, starting in 1980 when he entered the bond pit at the Chicago Board of Trade. In a short span, he emerged as a preeminent market maker in U.S. Treasury bond futures. In 1990, they joined forces and co-founded Marquette Partners. Initially a small arbitrage desk in Chicago, it rapidly expanded into a global liquidity provider with offices in major cities including London, Paris, Frankfurt, and Milan. Heinz and Moore also have stepped forward as thought leaders on how best to maintain high standards and best practices through their participation in a wide range of industry boards and committees.
Well, it's my pleasure and honor to introduce two members of the 2024 Futures Industry Hall of Fame. Jimmy Heinz and Rob Moore, who are our first Simon and Garfunkel inductees to the Futures Industry Hall of Fame. They certainly deserve to be in the Hall of Fame as individuals, but really are known for partnering together over the years to make an incredible impact on the futures industry and its shape today. So welcome, Rob and Jimmy, to this honor, and congratulations.
Thank you, Walt. Appreciate it. Very honored.
Everybody has a start. Everybody has a break. So tell us a little bit about the early part of your career, how you got into the futures industry, and if there were mentors along the ways, people influential on giving you a start in our business.
I started working for my dad when I graduated from Marquette University, where Rob and I were friends. And by the way, our wives were roommates, so we've known each other for so long, it's hard to believe. But anyway, my dad had an office in the Board of Trade building that was a printing and copying company. And I had a lot of friends and classmates and acquaintances that I knew from upstairs that were trading the agricultural futures. And then they were introduced to Ginnie Mae product back, I think, before 78. And then sometime around 78, I know I entered May of 78 as a Treasury bond permit holder. And my brother-in-law at the time, God rest his soul, Mark Leahy, suggested I get one of these permits and trade on the floor in the bond pit because he thought it was going to be huge. And so I'll never forget May 1978, my first day on the floor, coming into the pit and walking around. I called my brother-in-law up. I said, hey, Mark, just a question here. When do you buy and sell? And he goes, Jim, that's a $64,000 question. Okay. So it started going along, and I was keeping Rob abreast of what was going on. We vacationed with our wives, and we started talking about coming to the floor. And then I preceded Rob, but then I think in 80, you came down, and he became a fixture down there as a very successful trader, and very proud of him and his brothers too. So that's really where I got my start. Rob, you can talk about your start.
Yeah, I was an ex-school teacher, business school, or high school business teacher, and also a stockbroker at Payne Webber. And my entry is Jim. We went on a trip to Palm Springs, and this was after the all-important Paul Volcker speech of October 6th of 79, and it was January of 80, and Jim was just telling me about how things had taken off, and so I went at 2 in the morning, I woke my wife up in Minneapolis, Minnesota, and said, I'm going to go try it out. So I went down in July of 80 and went into the bond pit. So in many ways, you know, we were at the dawn, especially Jim, at the dawn of the bond pit.
Describe the atmosphere, because I'm a little jealous of those, you know, those years. And you hear people tell the stories of the excitement, the newness, the creativity, the innovation. Give us a little flavor of what it was like to be in the 1980 bond pit, because it seems legendary.
I'll just say that it was substantially smaller than it was at its closure, because there was only about, well, I'd say 50 guys in there.
It was in the South Room, which was right now is the lobby for Arbor trading floor. It was so exciting because the guys that were going into the bond pit were young. Jim and I were on the older side, believe it or not, at 28, 29. There was just so much enthusiasm. The grain guys were sort of hands off. They didn't know if it was going to work or not, but there was a real camaraderie and an excitement that we were onto something totally new.
The volumes were really small, but the volatility, especially after Volcker, was really high. And so I remember when I did my first 10 lot, I bought a 10 lot at 30. It went down to 01. That was $10,000. That basically would have wiped me out. And then when rallied all the way back to 31, I sold it for like a tick or something. And I thought I was going to have a heart attack. Okay. Yeah. But it was nothing traded on the way down, nothing traded on the way up. That's just the way it was. And it grew the attention of more people coming in. Then they launched associate memberships and they expanded the pit, and we eventually outgrew the Ginnie Mae product.
And we were so excited to go to work. I mean, we never left the pit. Yeah. You couldn't leave the pit because you'd lose your spot.
Yeah.
So you never left the pit. There was a legend in the pit at that time, a couple guys that Jim and I looked up to, Terry Cullerton and Frank Doherty. And Terry Cullerton was legendary. At the time, he was trading 50 lots. Cool. The rest of us were trading ones and tens. But anyway, Terry would leave the pit and come back. And whenever he came back, I don't know why, he always sold it. I'm in the pit and I look over and I see Terry coming into the pit. He's gonna sell it. I'm looking for an edge any way I can get it. So I sell it 10 lot, which at the time was a lot for me. Terry comes into the pit, puts up his hand and starts buying it instead of selling it. And the market rallied about a half a point. And that was my first big loss. And I realized, don't make assumptions.
Is there a personality trait that maybe distinguished the both of you from, you know, obviously very successful over the years, but, you know, did you have a tolerance for risk, or was it, you? Hey, we're young, we're dumb, we're just having fun, you know?
I think young and dumb is a real good description of what it needed to be. But I think there was also an element of risk-taking that a lot of guys that were successful possessed. I don't think I was one of them necessarily, but, you know, that was something as we grew into Marquette, we were always looking for as ingredients and guys.
I'm going to add something that I think, because let's face it, 70-80% of the people in the pit didn't make it. Yeah. And then you go further, of the guys that did make it, that came out and had a career after. Jim in particular, but myself included, we had incredible discipline. Every time I put a trade on, I assumed the president was going to be assassinated. And I had, where was my out? Jim and I both at Marquette, and especially in the pit, I think we're known for our discipline.
True. We're very disciplined.
You saw technology coming, right? You saw the power of some of these electronic trading systems. Walk us through when that first became part of your consciousness of, you know, hey, something's happening here. We got to be a part of it. I'm just curious when that became really relevant.
I was going to say, in 84, I left the pit. It was crowded. We moved into the south, not the south room, but the old grain room. I decided to go off the right on myself, cleared. And, you know, with a friend of mine, Matt Scanlon, is Apple had introduced the Apple IIe computer. And I thought, okay, let's take a look at some, maybe we can look at some of these traditional technical models and see if we can come up with some way to make money. And he was adept at this kind of thing, and we would work on those. We'd had to almost hand optimize the data that was produced by the Apple IIe, and we did a lot of trading. And that was my first experience with, there's something to this, right? There's something to the technical indicators, there's something to the computer. And I became very familiar with it. We had a very successful 84, I did with Matt, and then 85, we lost everything we made at 84. And I said to Matt, I had to go back to the pit. And it was when I came up and I was telling Rob, I said, I think I'm gonna go back to the pit. And he suggested that you should look into night bonds, which they had just launched. And I did that. And it was in there that I sniffed around and I thought, there's some things going on here that all, you know, off hours trading and some of the things going on in London at the time, and ran into somebody that was doing an arbitrage between London and Chicago. And that's starting when I went to Rob and I said, hey, Rob, we should do this. And we had very modest expectations, Walt. And we started an arbitrage between the London life bonds and the Board of Trade bonds. And we figured maybe we can cover salaries and this would be something that would work. Remember that?
Yep. So I think we backdoored into electronic a little bit. Jim had an experience, but when we were doing this, arb from the open outcry London to Chicago's bond pit, and we're having fun with it, we started to hear about the German government was not happy that Life was trading the Bruins, their right. national sovereign debt. So we heard of this little exchange called the DTB. And so we went to Frankfurt and sort of sniffed it out. At the time, Cash Mallman was in London and sort of helped us set this up. So we became one of the very early participants in the DTB. And within a year or two, 91, 92, we had seven ARBs that were trading the DTB to open outcry. So we were, you know, the screen was a big box with the, you know, with the green lighting, and, you know, it was pretty archaic, but we were very successful at it. And all of a sudden we said, hey, let's look around. So we went to Milan, to Italy. We started arbitrage in the Italian bond against the open outcry in Life. Then we went to Paris and we started doing that. By the end, we had like 13 ARBs. So that's how we got exposed to electronic trading very early, 91. And when you think about it, I mean, because electronic trading really didn't hit the States until 98, 99, significantly. And it's one of those things. When you see it and you feel it, you just know where the direction's going.
Very rare that one market's liquidity will move to another market. It sounds like you were early adopters of DTB at the time. Tell us, do you have any recollections of that? Because it happened relatively quickly, is my understanding.
I do recall on trips when we opened an office in Frankfurt and interacted with a lot of German nationals that were involved at the exchange level. And our clearing level, there was a certain sense of this is a very urgent issue with them, that they wanted to control the trading of their sovereign debt. It was very important to them. And you know, when you think about it, you understand why. And so when Life, they were a little dismissive of the Upstart exchange, and they were dismissive of electronic trading and didn't think they had a chance because there was a certain you know, elegant self-regard by all of us that traded as open outcry participants, that nothing could replace it. And yet, boy, I'll tell you, the Germans rallied some.
So they made it mandatory, basically, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, you're right, Rob.
They made it mandatory for the banks that if they were to trade, they had to trade X amount on the DTB. And so you would see these 500 lots come. I mean, it was tremendous. And by the way, they didn't care about the price or edge. They had to put my orders into the DTB. So it was just their goal was to take the liquidity back, and, well, steal it. As you said, I think it's the first time it ever happened.
The pit was a small world, right? And you know, when I got to know you in the last, you know, 10 years, it's clear that you guys are some of the best well-liked people in our industry. And everybody has great things to say about your character, who you are as people, and you're clearly likable, both of you. But I'm just curious, you know, in the pit environment, that has something to do with your success as well, the integrity, the character. Talk a bit about how that may have played throughout your career.
If you were less than honest and ethical in the pit, you'd be run out. At least that we self-policed in our pit. At least we did, I thought. And I don't think Robert or I never had a thought of doing anything untoward. You know, I mean, there were some bad characters. You heard all the stories. There definitely were some bad characters. They had the investigation by the feds back in whenever it was. It was in 89. And, you know, there were some bad characters, but they weren't evident to everybody in the general population. But at that time, it was maybe 500-600 people in the pit. But mostly it was self-policed by brokers and large traders, and everybody kind of, you know, respected everybody else. And so, but it did exist at certain times, and they were dealt with.
You remember the dynamics of the pit, the bond pit in particular. We had brokers and locals on the top step, you know, and then sort of based upon your size of trade, it scaled down from there. I would say the top two rows around that did 95% of the business, it was understood you have integrity or you're not going to be, no one's going to trade with you.
That's right.
And I have to admit, I had two or three guys on my list that knew, don't hit me because don't take from me because I'm not going to write it on the card, because at some point they were dishonest.
What would you say, you know, if you had to write your legacy, both of you, what would be sort of those highlights? What would be the crowning achievements of your careers?
I'm very proud of my time in the pit. My legacy is Marquette Partners. I loved teaching when I was I taught economics in high school. I had the ability to combine teaching and my love of trading. Trading, I knew, was my one thing, my thing that excited me and motivated me. So putting those two together, getting the work, we were trying to talk. We probably had over the 33 years, 400 or 500 at least, young men and women come through our doors, and many, many, many that have gone on to very successful careers and started other firms. And we're very proud of that. My ability to work with young guys, to educate them on something that I was good at, and that I was able to translate to them.
Well, I'd have to agree with Rob about what he just said. I felt my role was more of I sparked ideas, but in the end, it was the hard work and talent of the exceptional team we put together that why we're here today. And Rob had a huge part in mentoring all those people. And I think they'd say the same thing about their experience with him and myself, hopefully. But I was kind of the guy that said, you know, the widget guy, you know, that's okay, maybe we could do this, or maybe we could do that, or maybe, you know, what about this? What about life, natural gas? That's kind of my legacy.
Jim was always looking for the next opportunity.
Yeah, always looking.
Always looking for the next opportunity. And I was dealing with the present opportunity.
And I would always bring it to Rob because this guy has got incredible intuition. I would always say, Rob, what do you think of this idea? And you were always usually pretty on board, you know. And, you know, fortunately, we were lucky. But again, it's the team that we had and their hard work and talent that really is why we're here, you know. Wasn't anything specifically that I did. But so I would say that'd be my legacy. The idea guy, if there's such a thing.
Rob, I'd like to ask you, what do you love most about Jimmy and why he's being put in the Hall of Fame? If you could give one quality of why this partnership has worked over the years.
Well, first of all, the quality that I've loved of him for the 50 plus years we've been great friends, is his sense of humor. He's hysterical, just take my word for it. But as far as work goes, he said it. He's a dog with a bone. When he gets onto something, I mean, there is no rock unturned, no detail. You know, I would not like to be on the other end of an interrogation by Jim. He would have made a good SS guy or whatever. He really knows how to get down to the detail. I'm not a detail person. Jim is an incredibly organized, go for it, get all the info, move forward.
He's the most ethical, honest person I've ever met, very generous to a fault. And I've learned so much from him and being his partner for, you know, knowing him for 50 years.
Like you said, 400 or 500 people come through Marquette Partners over the years. What a legacy. But if you were giving somebody entering our industry some advice, you know, of our industry, what would you bring to our industry? What would you teach them? What would you say are the critical attributes needed to come into our markets and be successful?
Competitiveness. For a while, all we hired was athletes. You know, I always would joke the guys, you know, you're in the Hall of Fame if you bat 330 career life in baseball. That means you're only right one out of three times. So the competitiveness, we hired a ton of pro athletes, college athletes. The second thing is what Jim talked about, telling them to do it the right way, the ethical way, the hard work, and that it's not going to be a quick success. A lot of guys are coming to this business, they think it's a quick success. It's not. It's a journey, and you have to pay your dues. And if you are a competitive, ethical person, there's people around you that you can reach out to that are mentors that will show you the edge. We all, let's face it, you make money by having some type of edge. And the people, if you reach out and talk to people and respect people, people will help you. They'll help you find that edge.
And Jimmy, how about you? What advice
I want to add just on what he just last thing he just said is when I started in the business, the Terry Culletons and the Frank Dohertys, who I identified when I walked in there into the pit, you know, in 1978, were the guys that I said, okay, these guys understand what's going on. So I would seek them out. I would say, hey, Frank, hey, Terry, can I buy you lunch? I just want to ask you a lot of questions. I'm just learning. I want to learn more. And I would sit down and have lunch with them. And I'd take notes because I used to be a journalism major in college at Marquette. I would take notes of what they said while I'm talking to them. And I would think about, you know, I just studied the guys that were the best examples of success, and that I wanted to be around those guys. So I think don't be afraid. It's a people business. If I were to say anything to anybody, always be talking, identify the guys that are really successful at it, and don't be afraid to approach them and talk to them about what it takes to become successful, because they're flattered that you're interested in or acknowledging the fact that you think that they're great or not great, but they're successful, and they're more than willing to pass on what they know. And that's how accumulating that information is better than getting it from Uncle Frank that has an idea which way interest rates are going. You know, it's really identifying the best people and getting to know them.
Jimmy and Rob, thank you so much for all that you've given to our industry and the impact that you've had on our industry over the 30 plus years that you've been part of it. So we appreciate everything that you've done. And I just want to congratulate you on behalf of all the FIA on being inducted in the 2024 Hall of Fame class.
Thank you, Walt.
Thank you, Walt. Appreciate it very much.